Previously on Eldest Born.
I'm here with co-hosts of a podcast that I'm a big fan of called the Popcornie Podcast. If we were to like theorize what the big three would be considered back then, it would probably be Speed Racer,
yeah.
Astro Boy, and Gigantor.
So then this guy decides to take it upon himself to draw a raunchy comic book cover of Batman going down on Catwoman on the building. Oh, Joker, if you really think about it, is one of the most disturbing villains. And probably one of the most iconic ones.
And he has no superpowers.
No.
He's just a psychotic nutjob. Iron Man 2 had him in the gray suit. Then they did Iron Patriot. And then they brought him back in the gray suit for Civil War.
Yes.
And then they put him back in the red and blue suit for Endgame. Did you notice that?
I like the Norton version, to be honest with you.
Yes. Okay. Incredible Hulk is the best incarnation of the Hulk on screen.
Yes.
Or
hands down. What? That's not Venom. That's Eric.
No, there's some heavy. That's some heavy topics.
During Christmas, I don't know if you guys saw. I don't remember what the movie was exactly called. I watched it with my parents, but Ryan Reynolds and Will Ferrell made a Christmas movie together.
I heard about that. I didn't see it.
Yo, let me tell you, I was like, that's going to be a crazy duo. Movie sucked. Literally.
To be fair, Will Ferrell is not movie-wise for me anymore. I don't think he's that funny.
No, you know what
anymore.
The whole movie was about? A
Christmas?
Musical.
Oh.
Christmas uh-huh. musical.
That is so bad.
Just, think about a PG-13 movie. It's all Christmas related, and all Christmas related. But think about it. Literally, you find out Will Ferrell was Scrooge, and Ryan Reynolds is like the Scrooge of now generation. And they try to add their own humor
that's
into
terrible.
It.
No, that
they're
that
in a musical.
My head just exploded trying to make sense out
Bro,
of
like,
it. That's crazy.
It's like Scrooge of Christmas Past.
Yeah, in a way, and like you find out that. It's weird. Like, an easy summary is, there's a group of people during, they're not considered elves, but they work for, during Christmas time, and they're, they're kind of, dead in a way, but they, it's, their spirit, but it's them, and they work in a shop, and they, kind of just go around the people who are very, unbelievable in Christmas.
Yeah.
And obviously, the one main character was Ryan Reynolds, and he basically was, the Scrooge of our generation now. In the real world, and then Will Ferrell was the one who was like, you know what, I like this guy and I want to take him and make him believe again. And then you find out Will Ferrell was actually the original Scrooge in the past, and then it's a whole musical, and it's like, oh.
No, see, you lost me even trying to explain that
to
me.
The best part of the whole movie was when they would tell someone good morning, because that meant F you. That was the whole best part of the movie.
Oh my gosh.
Oh, that's terrible.
This is
I'm
the
so
trash
glad
they
I
come up
yeah,
with nowadays.
I'm so glad I
Dude, it took
that
me my
shot.
Parents 2 nights to finish it because we were this is ridiculous.
And like you said, you think of the cast on paper, it would sound amazing.
Yes.
And then when you watch it, it's like, wow, what a freaking letdown that was, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, that stinks. That's terrible. That was... Oh, man.
So, yeah, so you both seem to be going through quite a lot of series, especially you, because you had mentioned that you have all these different movies and series you're going through. Right now, I'm up to date with you, right?
Mm-hmm.
I'm currently keeping up to date with the One Piece dubbed.
Nice.
Okay.
Only
yeah.
because I can't stand Japanese voice acting, and I don't have time to read subtitles. The way that I binge shows, I hate to admit this, but I've said this on other episodes,
mm-hmm.
I literally watch it while I'm working. I watch it when I'm in the car,
I
keep it low down
so
I can't see it, but I'm listening to stuff, watch it at home. I can go through an entire season of a show in one day easily.
Mm-hmm.
40 minute episodes, Netflix, whatever it is.
Right.
I'll back you up, bro.
Mm-hmm.
When I was recently delivering parts for Lexus, and I made a contraption in the vehicle with a phone holder, and I took the phone holder,
Smart.
And it was it's a very old, 2003 Toyota Tundra.
Mm-hmm.
So it's literally just fits two people. And that's it. It's, and It's small on the inside, and like right next to the steering wheel and the stick shift, you got this little air vent. And what I did was I put double-sided tape around the phone holder. I duct taped it. I literally snapped that thing so hard onto the air vent that like it honestly did not move anymore. So much duct tape was on it. Some people got it and looked at it like, what the heck is this? And they were like, so whatever. But what I would do was I'd put my phone on the thing and it's in perfect eyesight, like perfect view. Like I'm sitting here. Here's the wheel. Here's the phone. And I would just, every show, I'd just be...
As you're doing.
Bro, I was getting through everything.
And just people... don't do that on the ride home. Okay? No. It's dark out. You know what I mean?
They make like a suction cup.
They do. I have it in my car. Yeah, glass.
The window.
Yeah. You
can... So he didn't want to pay the $5. No, he just used a bunch of duct tape, broke the vent.
You're correct. Because like, I was like, you know, they're not paying for it. And I'm like, I don't want to pay for it. So I was like, I'll make my own. And it actually worked.
Yeah, you find a way, make a way.
Like, it was so funny because people would be like, you don't... I told only certain people. I obviously wouldn't tell that to everybody. Mm. But, like, I was always... Even though, like, I can't say, like, anything could happen. It's a pretty dumb decision. But, like, I was always very careful when I was doing it. Mm. Like, I always made sure. Like, I wouldn't... If I was doing it, I wouldn't drive fast. I'd go, like... Right. I'd stay in the right lane and go, like, 40, 50 the whole way.
Sure.
And then...
You're being responsible as you binge watch.
Yeah. And like the funny part was people who I told are like, bro, like you probably don't even understand what's happening. You don't know what's going on in the show. I'm like, all right, first off, like if you know me with shows, like, yes.
No, you're paying attention. You're getting the details.
I was paying attention.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's my experience with that.
Yeah. So I do binge watching, but I don't binge watch the shows. I actually do the audible with the books. So sometimes if I know I'm going to be driving back and forth or if I'm at the gym or something like that and I can't physically have my book, I'll do an order, or like an audible. Mm-hmm. Not as dangerous and risky. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like, you know, the adrenaline junkie over here.
Dude, like, you don't even understand. Like, I was on high alert the entire day. Like, my eyes are going back and forth, head shaking. I was having, like, there were some days where I actually was, like, having, like, a headache after because I'm, like, going back and forth so many times.
You're watching a video and then you're watching oncoming traffic, you know? Right. It's a lot of things.
And every
happening.
Now and then, the oncoming traffic is a little too close to the front of your car.
Yeah. Oh, there you go. When you get really invested, you're in trouble. that's a risk right there.
Yeah, because like he said, there were times where before I invented that contraption in the car, I would hold my phone like this because my phone is kind of big.
Yeah.
So like I would hold it like this. And I would just have it up in the air. And then my shoulder is like weak now because I've been holding it for so long.
Don't let your mother listen to this.
No, she's not.
No.
It's too funny.
You will not have that car no more, man. That'll be it.
Didn't your car just get repaired recently?
I mean, him crashing that car sounds a lot more believable after how he told us how he watches and drives.
I got a new car.
Okay.
And, yeah, because I got into...
A little fender bender.
Fender bender. It's a little more.
Be very light about it. Yeah, it was not just a fender bender.
I got into a full accident. Totally totaled my car.
Oh man, I'm sorry.
It's all right. Yeah, because I told you about that. Because you wanted to do something with me, and I was like, I can't even get anywhere.
Right, I don't know where to go.
And then,
recently, my car had the transmission blow up.
That sucks.
It was just leaking transmission fluid that everywhere. Sucks. It was like overheating, smoking, smelling weird. I had to drop $3,500 on a new transmission.
And you know what's crazy? You're better off doing that because back then, before the prices were sky high, they would say, just get a different car. Mm-hmm. You know, it doesn't make sense to put that money in. It's actually better that you did that.
Yeah.
Because the prices on these vehicles are through the roof right now.
Plus, my car's like an older BMW. It's like 2005.
Oh, okay.
And that model, the engines are known to go up into the 200s.
Oh, wow.
And I'm like halfway through the 100s. I'm like 160.
Yeah, so you got plenty.
So I probably could push like another 100,000 miles.
Oh, absolutely with that, yeah. Cars were built to last a lot better than now. You know, they want you to get in and out, especially with the shortage that we went through.
Mm-hmm.
Now the used cars are double the price. You're liking that, right? The shortage, everything, the chicken shortage, the egg shortage.
The eggs, yeah.
Egg plants. Egg factories are blowing up randomly out of nowhere. Like
the respectable women's shortage.
It's crazy how all this is happening. There's a shortage of, well, that's good stuff. It's a crazy time to be alive right now. I'll tell you that.
Gosh. It's
It's ridiculous. Literally everything. Mm-hmm. As I literally say, prices go up, and you pay more, and you get paid less.
That's true. That's very true. Even when you run your own business, like I run my own business, and it's tough because when everybody takes a hit, they're not really going to come in and try to spend their money how they used to. You know, everything's tighter, prices got raised, and then obviously I have to raise mine. So, you know, I am still affordable, but just the fact that everybody was used to this one price, I can't even live the way I did last year if I didn't change my price. You know, it's just the times are kind of tough. You know, it kind of stinks right now. But that's another reason why I started going in with the comic books, because it's almost like a cheaper route to make money. Sure. Gym equipment is triple the price right now. Mm-hmm. Like a slam ball that weighs 20 pounds is like almost $80, and you get one.
Right.
When I could get like 100 comic books for like $50 and sell it and like double my money with that. You know, not quitting my gym business, but I need something else to bring like a second income in.
You want to hear the craziest story? When I was young, there was a comic book shop called Bailey's Comics right on Main Street in Lyndhurst, and they had a comic book box of 25-cent comics.
No.
Now, this is like, my entire childhood was 25-cent comics. I went in there with $20.
Oh, you clean house. Comics, yeah, like, clean house. Yep.
And one day, the price went up to 50-cent comics. Now, just think about that. Like, it's not a lot of money because 50 cents is 50 cents. Right. But from an inflationary standpoint, the amount of comics you could buy just got cut in half. Like, if you had a $100 bill, you used to be able to buy 400 comics. Now you can only buy 200 comics.
Exactly, yeah. And now look at the prices now. $2.49 for a comic. It would be $1.99 for a comic, depending on the variant. Like, the 100th issue of Nightwing. So there's about 15 covers of that. So I ordered 5. And they were like $20 here. And then the one I really wanted was $450. Just for one cover.
Retail?
Yeah.
What?
Because it was a 1.25 cover, and it was sketched by the artist.
Okay.
But $450, and that's going price now. That's not even what you could get for it when you frame it, airlock it, you know, so then you could double that price as well. But it's nuts, like how you said 50 cents, even a dollar a comic. Like, we think that's a deal now when you look at the comic that says 25 cents. It's really nuts. You're really right. You went from getting 200 comics to now 100, maybe 5, maybe 20.
I think the newest comics that have just been releasing are like $5, $6.
That's like the normal price.
That's normal. That's insane.
Pretty much the normal price. That's insane. Yeah.
And they're like half as thin as the...
They changed the whole material.
Yeah.
You know, it's supposed to last more, but it's just something about having the real paper pages. Mm-hmm. It just, that would always be a real comic for me. You know?
I recently purchased, what is it, Detective Comics issue 1,000, something like that?
That's a good price. That's going to go up a
Which
lot.
Which was, depending I on bought the variant that you few have. Years ago.
Yeah. Oh, that's going to go. If you could grade that price would definitely go through the roof. And have a bidding war online.
Yeah, you think?
Honestly. So? Oh, yeah. eBay, bidding is everything on there. You start off with, like, say, depending on that, you could probably start off with $100, depending on the price on it. Mm. And, you know, as long as it's in good condition. And then people will bite on that.
Yeah.
You know? And then they'll sell it when the Batman movie comes out. Mm. You know? So it's good stuff. But you know that's why, I went that route.
You know that sign print I have above our heads?
Yes.
They won't be able to see it on camera, but you were talking about it. I actually... That is the centerfold of that issue.
That's cool.
So I found the artist who drew it when we were going to Comic-Con that year in the artist alley, and I got him to, like, sign it. Like,
I was so mad I missed you guys. And then I didn't know there was a downstairs with the signing and everything. Mm-hmm. So I told him. He knows it, too. Like, I spent so much money upstairs. And then my friend Tom is like, oh, let's go downstairs. We can get autographs signed. And I'm looking at it. I'm like, I literally just spent, like, $600 upstairs. Yeah. Like, now you take me to the guy who made this comic book, who made Superman. So we met the guy who did the Death of Superman series. Mm. And he was probably the coolest person to sign anything. He charged very little, but he took pictures with you. He talked with you. He wanted to get to know why you liked this series so much. There was a couple other people I won't say on here that they just kind of hear. There you go.
Sure.
See you later. Keep it moving.
There's so many people there, so you kind of...
But it's like, this guy's like, he started it all, and he still takes the time. And he was there with his daughter, which is really cool. So the daughter is drawing some of the action comic book series right now. And they took the time to get to know you, talk, you know, they kind of put their ego in check and shook your hand and stuff like that. Some of them didn't really do that over. I get it. Like, Tom McFarlane, I think it was like $75 just to take a picture. That's not even autographed.
What did he...
He does all the toy lines, pretty much. And he created some of the most classic comics And he did a lot of Spider-Man runs in the 90s, a lot of the Batman covers. He drew the Batman and Spawn covers. Mm. All those, that's Tom McFarlane.
Yeah.
And then the vampire, Batman one issue of him being a vampire, which if in good condition, not even graded, it's worth $150 right now. So imagine that graded and everything, you know. But that would double if you wanted to ask him to sign it. And he selected which ones he wanted to sign. So he had a list that could probably go from the table to the door. So sure. I was like, what do I bring? Yeah. You know, it was crazy.
I'm a big fan of like Grant Morrison.
Yes.
Jim Lee.
Jim Lee's like amazing. Absolutely.
But that's awesome.
And who was it? I forgot. Who was the guy when you took me down to the art gallery that you bought like the whole series of his art stuff?
Go on the shelf there. You see the white box set? You're going to have to, like, right on the same shelf that your head is at.
Right here?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. I got you.
Yeah.
I don't want to knock this down.
Mm-hmm.
Take it all out?
Yeah, take them all out.
Oh, yeah.
There's one more book.
There's one more book. Hold on 1 second. All right. Here you go.
All right.
That's a nice box set, by the way. Just that alone.
I don't want to, like, cover you.
All right,
I'll just hold it.
And hide my gap tooth anyway. You're doing justice.
So, to answer your question, shout out to Timothy Von Ruden.
Yeah.
It says it on the
gold pages, sure. Too, man.
His Instagram handle is called Von Art.
Okay.
And he is a, like, pencil illustrator.
That's awesome.
Now, I have one original of his at home. It's like a Kingdom Hearts illustration where Sora from Kingdom Hearts and Donald and Goofy are, like, real to form. So Sora's just a boy, but Donald and Goofy are like duck and a dog, and they're holding their like magic weapons in their mouths.
That's
cool. It's really cool.
Yeah, that's cool.
So he does these like awesome illustrations, and these art books are just every illustration he did from that year. So it's like a lot of fantasy stuff, and he just goes through like all the different things. Like this is Harley Quinn. And this is the piece that I.
That's have. Really really cool.
I have the original. Like,
oh,
if you
have
you
the
take
original
a eraser
really?
To it, it'll rub off.
But, oh wow!
I have it framed in my room at my dad's house.
That's crazy.
But that's cool that he sold the book out. You see where his mind, you know, his creativity and his mind. He's just sketching a little bit here, a little bit there.
I have a bunch.
That's really cool.
I have a bunch of prints by him also, but to be honest with you, I think these art books are the most efficient way to get his artwork in your hands. Like, he did a card series, which I have on the shelf over there, too, but it's best just to look at it here. Like, these are the kings, queens, jacks.
That's so good.
And that's the back of the card. And we actually played with these cards on another episode of the Three Brothers podcast.
Oh, that's cool.
My co-host.
You did, yeah.
And the girls that we had on there.
Yeah.
That's cool.
We were playing, like, a drinking game that involved playing cards, and we used these. So look how awesome.
That's amazing, man. That's another reason why I fall in love with comics and their artists, because their imagination and how they bring the detail out, and everybody has their own niche, their own style, their own way of doing things.
Yeah.
And this is a really cool set. Yeah, like, think about it. You wouldn't even want that colored in.
No.
You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just amazing artwork within itself.
The
and
use
the booking
of like,
is really,
the
really
use
cool.
of like line weights and like shading. I didn't even know half this stuff could be done with pencils. It's wild.
And it's the technique. If you ever watch like how people draw, they have like YouTube things like that. They'll have a small pencil to kind of fade out the shading this way. Then they take like another one that I've never seen it before. They for the lining.
Yeah.
Then they take another way for the sketch outline. It's just like it's so in depth how certain artists do. And then my tattoo artist, Whitey, shout out to him. He would just kind of freehand something, and then you literally see his wheels going as he's bringing it to life, like literally on you or on the paper. For me, that's like a really cool artist because
that's
it's like
terrifying.
he would do like when he drew this on it first, it was just a marker, and then he just went like this, and I'm looking at him, and I've been going to him since like 2009, and I'm like, I'm going to kill him. It looks nothing like what I want. And all of a sudden, he's just shading it. And this is all shading. There's no real lining on that at all. And look how good that came out. So for me, for that imagination to pop up on somebody's skin or a piece of paper, that's just God-given talent.
Tattoo artistry is something that blows my mind.
Oh, yeah.
So
how do you even do shading with a needle like that? Like,
well, it hurts, one.
Well,
two, but it just...
Yeah. The difference is with the shading part is like, because if you get line work done, like, like how this tattoo doesn't have any line work, it's just shading. Mine has a lot of line work, if anyone can see, but like there's different needles. Like the line work is you get one needle.
Yeah, one really short little needle. Yeah,
it's like one needle, and he goes over it like at least 2-3 times at most, and then shading is like 10 mini needles. So it's like a bunch of needles spilling out ink on you. So it's just like, it's like drawing, it's like coloring with one of those fat markers.
Right.
Yeah.
But then you have to apply pressure at different depths to like get the
shading. Like the really cool part because you remember you can't erase. You know, so you really, if you think about it, we're putting a lot of trust in the tattoo artist. So the fact that they pull off the work that they do is absolutely stunning.
That's insane.
Yeah, just by you actually showing off the art books from,
go for it.
I brought, if anyone's a Bleach fan, Bleach, out of all the animes I've watched, Bleach is my favorite art style of any anime. And the author, he made a whole book just of the Bleach artwork that he does, but his artwork is unique and different because he, instead of like having them dress normal as they do in the show, like their average outfit, like he actually puts like a spice to their like outfits. Like that's like a winter season outfit right here, that's a summer one. Like who thinks of a guy wearing
the skinny jeans, the Nikes, and the
one? You know, who thinks about wearing one orange glove and actually making it look good?
Like Michael Jackson.
Yeah, like there's all of that.
But
like,
wait, go back for 2 seconds. Yeah, because this kind of looks like a Kill Bill almost like pose.
Oh, look at that! Actually,
if you think about it,
I didn't even look at it that way. And,
like,
that's pretty cool.
And like what I love about him is that even though this is colored and like that's not colored. I like how he's making colors blend that shouldn't go together.
Right.
Like, this is like a turquoise blue mixed with white versus a regular blue and orange glove.
And then look at the background, too, with the maroon in the back. Yeah.
And then, like, even more, like, I don't even know, man. There's just so much. And then here's, like, just really their their styles from inside
this
the
whole
show.
Thing is cool.
Like, they're pretty simple, but still good. And then, like, then you get outfits like this. Like, this is them. He's got shades on. He's got chains hanging from his pants. Like, this one's wearing pink and green. That doesn't really, like... No, I don't feel like people could pull that off very
like the
much.
Stuffed animal going into action. That's so pretty cool.
And, like, I love how he always... He loves... I noticed with this artist, he really loves accessories. Like, I feel like a lot of main stuff don't really add many accessories. Like... A lot of shows do, but I feel like they just mostly fake, mainly focus, focus on just, like, just the character itself. Because, like, if you look at Goku from Dragon Ball Z, he wears the simplest outfit. But if you look at Ichigo from Bleach, he's got one glove on, he's got a scarf. That's a different color. Yeah. He's got one. He's got one long sleeve. One that's not. One's a short sleeve on the other arm, and like cool pants that are different color and still make it match. That's like the beauty of you were saying with artwork. How these people do that.
Yeah,
and I've always been artistic myself because I used to draw a lot, and once in a while I still draw. And like,
oh, look at the desert outfit.
Anime it's really like got me to love artwork, to be honest with you.
It's
because
like Arabian Nights kind of.
That's
like
so cool. Because it puts it to, there's even, you know, he's getting into the Star Wars stuff, so I don't know if he watched the anime samurai style. There you go. That's
my favorite.
That's
one.
What really drew
my
Tyler into
one.
It.
This is what Tyler bought the book for.
Yeah, don't let him fool you. Even though the whole speech from before, he's been hiding this for
he's
a
like,
while.
He's like, whoa, look at this.
Real quick take, out of every anime, Bleach Girls got it for sure. For sure.
To make that statement very clear.
Oh, no, that's a big statement. I think a lot of people agree.
So if you don't want the story, at least you get some good women on there for you. He recommends it.
Yes, for sure. There's Because the Japanese culture, you know, they make the, you know, they just like we the, know, yeah. they like yeah, to yeah. exaggerate the size.
I mean, look at Bulma. She
accentuate.
Even, yeah, even Bulma in Dragon Ball, she wishes for a bigger breast and a bigger butt from
Dude,
a wish. Yeah.
Dragon Ball, the yeah, original yeah. Dragon Ball, oh, the yeah. stuff that they were doing, like Goku was be checking 30. Everybody's genders in the middle of the episode.
Dude, I didn't Pulling realize that when I was and younger, and then when you rewatched that, I was like, My grandparents watched this with me. Like, they allowed me to do this.
Yeah. And he's like, Goku will just like lift up Bulma's skirt, be like, Bulma, yeah. what happened to your balls? And she'll be like, oh my gosh, where are they? And she'll be like looking through her like backpack.
Yeah,
oh wait, here, the Dragon Balls.
The, yeah, the little line is in there too. What? But if you notice, any female that was around Goku at that time always had a skirt or was in like a robe. Right. So it was like always easy access to this guy, and his sensei was a dog.
Oh,
Master Roshi. Yeah, I love that he brought him back in Super with the same personality. Yes. And
Although, did you see that move he does in Super where he like he's in the tournament?
Yes,
and he does a Kamehameha wave.
His greatest one that he would ever do. Yes. That was really really cool.
That was awesome.
And you know they did him justice in that. They really did.
Because if
like
you really
that.
Think about it, the one who created the Kamehameha was Master Roshi.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And Goku just took it and overpowered it, but like.
But I like how they still paid homage to him for having that. You know? I thought that was really cool. And they still had him hitting on everybody. Everybody.
Also, there's a really cool scene I saw online. Somebody clipped it together. In Super, Goku is training and he's sparring kind of just with the air. He's just like doing moves.
Homage. Yep.
And you see the moveset, and then they flashback in this clip to him and his grandpa.
Yeah.
What is it like? Grandpa Gohan?
Gohan.
And it's the same moveset. He's doing the exact same.
See, I'm so glad you said that because a lot of people don't realize that. Mm-hmm. That was homage to the original series. And the fact that they still brought it in 2015 and on to do that one scene in the same spot, I thought that was dope.
It's so cool.
Yeah, that was really, really cool. And you have to be like a real fan too to realize like how that was put together, you know? So good. Dragon Ball Z still doesn't get enough credit. Like, there's other stuff out there, but a lot of people don't think it's good enough story to kind of...
To be honest with you, it's not.
You know, I enjoyed it. I like the motivation of it, you know?
The storyline sucks, but the animation and the fight scenes and just the power sets, like...
Yeah.
It's created this archetype for shonens that everything else kind of bases it on, like...
Oh, yeah.
Leveling it up and, like, Plus Ultra is... Just a reworking of like, you know, pushing beyond your limits because Goku's always constantly
doing that. Yeah,
do like a next level of Super Saiyan.
Yeah, and if you think too, every anime star after you know Dragon Ball Z kind of mimics Goku's jawline anyway. Mm-hmm. Yeah, right or wrong, every major anime star usually is based off of Goku one way.
Luffy was actually based off of Goku from One Piece, but they made. I wouldn't say more realistic, but the power system.
Did it take five episodes for him to charge up?
No.
I think that fight scene with Frieza.
Oh, yeah. That was the longest charge up scene in history.
It was like 15 episodes. Something crazy.
It was ridiculous. Yeah.
Because the two longest fights I know in anime were Goku versus Frieza, and then it was Luffy versus Katakuri. I think Luffy versus Katakuri was like around 19 to 20 something episodes, like just a fight. And then. Goku and Frieza, a 5-minute fight took like 18 episodes.
The tournament of power was technically what, 45 minutes? And it was about like 10 episodes or longer?
More than that, right?
More.
Wouldn't the fight that just happened between Kaido and Luffy be longer than Katakuri?
No, I wouldn't say so because, Wano was long, but Luffy's only went up against Kaido twice, and one was when. Luffy got literally one hit, and you saw that part where Kaido was drunk. But besides that, like, they don't fight until like another 100 something episodes.
Oh wow!
So like, oh, like, wow. And then the fight is definitely long if you consider it, but like them actually like just them two fighting is not that long.
Okay. I thought Dressrosa was a long arc in that.
That was a little long.
It was, like, really dragging out for me, but I'm only starting Wano now, so I have yet to see what's going
to
go on.
I have to start that in general.
Yeah, you gotta.
Yeah.
Good luck.
I know. He tells me so much work, too, and I'm like, ugh.
My younger cousin Tessa is going through it right now. I keep telling her, like,
when episode like 450 comes around, just about, you're going to want to cry.
Oh, you just want to quit. That's the most heartbreaking episode. Heartbreaking part.
Yeah, it's a story arc that's just like gut-wrenching. But it's epic.
It's epic too.
Yeah.
And it's great because it was the older animation too. Mm-hmm.
That's still like my favorite, the old anime style, the drawing, the way everything viewed. Look at the Dragon Ball from the 90s. Dude. When he finally was Super Saiyan 3. That artwork, the fightsy choreographic, they even put in the movies.
I love the art style for Dragon Ball Z, like during the Saiyan arc.
Mm-hmm. Freaking amazing.
Or even like with the androids and stuff. Like,
so good.
Vegeta is so short. Yeah. And his like Widow's Peak is so like sharp.
He was my favorite character to draw. Yeah. I loved to draw Vegeta. I really did. He's one of my favorite anime characters too. Mm. I hope that they finally give him some of his due because he's the only one. Like, obviously, he rivals Goku, but he never really had the help that Goku had.
Yeah.
So you think about God Mode, Super Saiyan Blue, all that, he achieved all on his own. So I hope they do, like, a little arc where he kind of surpasses and let him finally beat characters. Like, he'll start off beating him, and then either Goku will take over, or out of nowhere, Vegeta just gets his ass kicked. He's gone for about, like, 5 scenes. You know, I feel like they kind of do him dirty.
I don't know how true this is, but I saw something online, a YouTube video where a guy was like, if you really pay attention, every time Goku and Vegeta fight, Vegeta always actually wins.
Well, the first show, he did win. It just, Krillin was going to kill him with the sword, and that's when they kind of stopped everything. Mm-hmm. So he technically won that fight, too, I think.
But he's never lost a fight against Goku, ironically. Even though Goku's the most powerful Saiyan.
Yeah, out of all of them. And I did like the end of, what movie did we go to? Heroes.
That was funny.
When they fought for the entire time and they did the slow motion punch. He's like, I finally beat Kakarot.
Yeah.
Oh my girl didn't understand it, and Broly and the other guy is sitting there crying and everything. Because it was deep. He finally got the win that everybody got to see him do.
That got the theater rolling.
That was good. That was good. That was such a good movie. I'm so glad I went with you to go see that, actually. That was awesome. Beast Gohan better be canon going in.
Yes,
they gotta start doing that. They finally brought back Piccolo.
No,
I don't like the red eyes, and his hair color looks too much like Ultra Instinct to me.
Well, they brought back the Super Saiyan 2 hairstyle.
Yeah,
just added the silver color and then the red eyes. I like the red eyes.
Piccolo's charge up, to be honest with you. Piccolo's new form. It was so overdue, and it was so badass how he did that. Absolutely badass. Yeah,
the character you said you need some credit is definitely Piccolo.
Yeah, because it's like when they brought him in, he technically was the first one to beat Goku, right?
Yeah, he was King Piccolo.
Piccolo, you know, he killed a bunch of people too. Then he started training them. So then out of nowhere, why did he suck for like so long? But then he's still like the ultimate sensei out of them all too, you know?
But he was the ultimate sensei for Gohan. That's why they're so closely linked. And like Gohan wears
his clothes. That's why I like the movie, how they really wrote that in.
You notice that?
Yeah. And then he did his finishing move at the end with Ultimate Cell, which I thought was really, really cool.
Goten wears Goku's outfit.
Yes.
And then Gohan wears Piccolo's outfit.
Piccolo's outfit, yep.
Yeah, Piccolo's the real dad of anime.
Absolutely.
He's the real daddy.
Wait,
did you ever see the video online? It was a recent interview with Pedro Pascal, who plays... What's his face in The Last of Us?
Yeah.
And they were like, some people online have been calling you, daddy.
Yeah.
And he's like, unfortunately, like, I'm not a father in real life, but I feel like daddy's a state of mind.
He's so witty, man. He's actually really, really good. So I like him. I really, really do. And The Mandalorians, you did. Anybody watch the new episode of Mandalorians?
I haven't seen it.
I haven't watched it yet either. Was
you
it
guys
good?
Both haven't?
No. I'm caught up in so many books and other shows to catch up to you in the anime world. Like, I lost track of what I was originally watching.
Yeah. I mean, you know? I wouldn't say the episode is anything to be, like, extremely hype about. It's going to be, it's like, it's good.
Okay.
But it's not like, wow, this episode is going to break the internet. No.
But we'll probably get something like that in like third or fourth episode, and that might take our breath away a little bit.
Because I got to be honest, because in Star Wars series that I've watched, The Mandalorian is absolutely my favorite besides Anakin Skywalker. Like,
Mandalorian saved Star Wars.
Yeah, I think so too. Mm-hmm. Like, literally, I felt, besides, I'm not going to lie, this might be a hot take, Maybe so.
It's gonna be a hot take, given all your other hot takes.
Right.
I like Rhea Skywalker. I like Rhea.
I like her.
That's a little just, bit.
When they I made her a Skywalker at the end of it, really, really just got grinded my gears. But also too, I was kind of hoping.
Family Guy.
Yeah, like, you like that, right?
It really grinds my gears. Yeah, you know that segment? That.
Yeah. Oh, I was hoping that they did like an Obi-Wan thing, like she was like a mischild of Obi-Wan that nobody knew about.
Nah, but legacy. She was like what Palpatine's granddaughter or something.
Yeah, a lot of people liked that movie. I personally did not like that movie.
The first hour and a half was all retcon.
Yeah,
because they had to make up for what the Last Jedi ruined. Ruin, so to speak. Like some people like that as a movie, but it wasn't really a good sequel to the.
No, Force it wasn't. Awakens. No, it wasn't at all. No.
But yeah, I'm not a big fan of.
No, either of those. That's why I mean like Mandalorian. Because after that, the Mandalorian came out a couple years later, and that's what everybody got jumped back on board. In my opinion, with Star Wars.
Yeah, because
you know, I can't even say Boba Fett series, because Boba Fett first couple episodes was great, and then I'm
Boba Fett.
You Boba mean? Fett, yeah,
bubblegum shrimp,
bubblegum. See, I told you, I butcher names a lot. No, it's okay. Really, really bad, you know? But if you think about it, the first couple episodes was great, and then we're like, what are we doing with this? It was boring.
Right.
He wasn't kicking anybody's ass. If anything, everybody was walking over him, over his reign of power, until the Mandalorian came in. And a black lightsaber, which was awesome. And then you found out the power wheeling behind that, because the harder you swing, the harder it's going to, the heavier it gets. It wasn't like your typical lightsaber.
Why is it shaped like a sword? Can somebody explain that to me?
Who made it?
Somebody, the Mandalorians made it to mimic with like their weapon, but also to overpower the Jedi's weapon. And they made it where not everybody can wield it. So the blade of it is going to whip a little bit different. It's supposed to be for stronger attacks. But like I said, it's really how you use it. So, I like the sword being, hey, there's something crazy in Star Wars that people don't realize. They have a lava sword. Yeah, nobody realizes that. Yeah, and the I think it's the Old Republic. One of the guys chose to make some type of lava sword. I don't know how that would work. I don't know how that comes out of your blade.
It's actual lava.
It's actually like an actual lava.
That's weird.
Yeah,
I know the colors of the lightsabers in the comics, the novels, the video games are green, blue, purple.
Yes.
Red, obviously, and then they also have
the yellow cannon. Finally.
The yellow is movie canon now, but it's always been canon in everything else.
And there was the gray Jedis that were like mixed with both. They were they dabbled. What I like actually,
they're like the Sentinels. More. They're called like they guard the temples.
Yes, very that's dead on. Actually,
they also have I think one more. Am I missing something? I think there was white. There was a white lightsaber.
See, that's where I was got confused, because if you watch the original Empire Strikes Back, the lightsaber was white. When they remastered it, it kind of looked, they gave it like a blue tint.
Well, that was just
they screwed up
effects.
On the toys too. A lot of the toys came out with the original Star Wars blades as white.
But that's not that was just what they had movie technology back then.
Yeah,
because it was always intended to be a color like. But the I middle like was white because though. It was like it's literally a beam of light. But
no, I get that
they got the color like mapping better nowadays.
No, they absolutely do. Now they actually have a book at Barnes & Noble's of every single lightsaber that was ever created. The double edge, you know, Count Dooku.
Count Dooku is the one.
He has the handle as.
The handle that's like a curve.
A little bit of a curve, And I forgot why they did that. They went into something canon that the reason why he made that handle was to be a better
duelist or something. There are different styles of Jedi, like, combat.
Yeah. And so, he was like top notch. Like nobody was beating him. Hand-to-hand. Like
my co-host Chris on the Three Bells podcast, he probably could give you a whole rundown of like the different styles.
Right.
But they're all like indicative of different like actual martial arts and sword fighting styles in real life. So like Yoda uses a different style than
He's Dooku. More force based than lightsaber based. He is. And I think it's like if you had a green lightsaber, you were more force bound. If you had like a blue one, you were more combat wise. I forgot how that all breaks up, but it's pretty cool. I definitely like it.
Yeah. All right. So you think we covered enough topics for today?
I think so.
I think so, man.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It was a pleasure, man. It really was.
Yeah. I'm really glad you guys got a chance to come on my podcast. Hopefully I'll get to be a guest on your podcast.
Absolutely.
Soon. Of course.
And also, I'm doing like a sort of mini series where I'm playing some co-op video games with friends and family.
Oh, cool.
And doing like little expose episodes about each game we finish. So I just finished It Takes Two
Okay.
for the Nintendo Switch.
Yep, know that game.
And Unravel 2.
How is that?
Which one?
Unravel 2.
It's a lot of fun.
It is a lot of fun?
Okay. I don't know if you played the first one, but it's like a co-op version of the first one.
My cousin did. Mm-hmm. I kind of like, I enjoy video games, and certain ones, like, I like to sit back and watch you get involved in it and stuff like that. I'm kind of like a viewer in that aspect. But that was cool. So, all right, I'll check out number 2 then.
Yeah. Well, that's awesome. The point I'm making is I would love to have either one or both of you. Like, we could hang out, play some video games on our free time, and then come on and maybe do, like, a little mini-episode sometime.
I'm down for that. Cool. 100%. Yeah.
Awesome.
Absolutely.
So, anyway, I want you guys to get some exposure. So, plug your podcast. Where can we find you guys? Where can we find Popcornie?
You
want to
do it? Why don't you do it? I do it all the time on our podcast back home. This is your time to shine, man. Let's do it. Speak loud and proud.
You can find the Popcornie Podcast on SoundCloud and Spotify. That's all you gotta look up is just the Popcornie Podcast. We're the only ones, so you got no excuses. And then Instagram, we're the Popcornie 1975. Find us there, give us a follow, and I don't know, stay TikTok with us.
share, subscribe.
Yeah, literally. TikTok as well. It's the same thing. Popcornie 1975. We just to sum up a little something here. We finished up a COC, the Clash of the Classics, and eventually we will be making polls of which characters go against each other, and you guys need to vote which ones you think would win. Because we just went through the whole draft of which characters, me, Sriracha, Tatsuquap, and our other friend,
Merc with the Mic. Gotta love the names.
Yeah, Merc with the Mic, all picked 14 street characters, 10 worldly characters, and 3 cosmic characters. And we just need you guys to pick who would win.
So it's like a multiverse.
Yes.
But it's not limited to just DC characters and Marvel characters. So I have Jim Carrey as a god playing from Bruce Almighty as like one of the characters to take somebody on.
Okay.
You know, you could pick Godzilla. You could pick Bugs Bunny. Bugs Bunny could be a world or a cosmic character because he can change into anything. Mm-hmm. You can get deep with it. You know, he can't die. It's a lot of fun. It really is. So we would like to get the fans involved. And we do have guests, so we would love for you to pick a couple characters for the next time. We are going to do part 2 very soon.
And it becomes almost like a bracket style.
Yeah, it's like a Mortal Kombat. Yeah.
And then the fans vote to see who wins.
Absolutely. Yes, that's really cool. Yeah. So we're going to start promoting that a little bit more in the next few weeks, actually.
Awesome, dude. And guys, as usual, you can find the Three Brothers Podcast and Three Brothers Eldest Born, which I affectionately consider the expansion pack of the Three Brothers Podcast. You can find us on Instagram at Three Brothers Podcast or at Three Brothers Eldest Born. We're on YouTube as Three Brothers Podcast, and we're also on Twitter, Facebook, and there's one other. Oh, we have a Patreon, which I have yet to make some more exclusive content for that, but there's one exclusive episode. If you want to check that out, you have to pay $1 to look at that. Just like easy if you want to like check out some exclusive content that's not released on YouTube or Instagram. But I hope you enjoyed this special collab. I was really excited to have these guys on, and I'm sure we're going to do some more stuff in the future.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Thank you for having us again.
Yes, thank you for coming. So we're signing off, guys. Sriracha's enjoy.
Out. Peace out.